Good morning. How are you,
cutie?
My man?
Hi.
How are you? You look so handsome.
This guy, you know, I went to go see Mitch the last time he was here. You know what's interesting about this? I never go out. I don't go.
Yeah, I was really honored, by the way.
The last guy I went to go see, I saw Kevin Pollak, because I think he's, I've never seen his stand-up, but I like his acting. I think he's a good guest.
Yeah, he's a good guy.
So I go to see you. This was maybe a year or two ago, and what I realize is, like, you almost have it's the same you, but it's a slightly different persona. Yeah. On stage, isn't it?
A little dirtier,
and a little like, yeah, a little creepier, like a little mousier, creepier. Like you were like a creepy.
Actually, it's different now because now I'm married, so it's less creepy and more about like how perverted I am my wife, kind of thing, but less creepy.
I don't know. That's in the eye of the beholder, probably.
And what I remember about you that shocked me is you had like the hottest girl I've ever seen come with you.
I don't even remember who
she
came
was
with me.
Smoking, and I couldn't even look at her like in the eyes. I was just so intimidated. She was really like a penthouse girl almost.
Boy, I'm going to have to think about
pulling that.
I'm going to have to think about what girl I took there that night.
Well, I've thought about her many times since then.
I have so many women, Mitch, that it's hard for me to keep track of them all.
But then I realize how big you actually are. I think that's how you can always judge.
By how ugly a guy is and how attractive the girl is.
Yeah. I mean, with me too. You know that, like, when you see a guy, you're like, okay, he's either packing in his pants or he's really, you know, or he's really
famous,
successful.
Famous or rich or something, or a combination of all of those.
Yeah.
Now, your wife, she's here, right?
I brought Jessica because the last couple of times I came, you asked me questions. I don't even think you believed a lot of the stuff I was telling you, so I told her she should come to Cleveland with me this
time. I'll bring her in a minute.
Yeah, so you can ask her all the stuff about this stuff.
I will. What have you been up to lately? The last time you were here, I think the military just like kicked you out of doing shows for the military.
Kicked me out. Finished a pilot for A&E. A&E decided not to pick it up, but they're trying to sell it now to another network. So
how does that work? A&E pays for the pilot. They make the pilot, and then they go, we're not going to pick it up, but now we're going to try and sell this that we don't want to someone else?
They did a lot worse than that. They actually did a show with me and Jess about Jess is bisexual, and they did a show, and she's allowed to be with and hook up with other girls when I'm not there. Like, okay. That's kind of our life. And so they wanted that aspect of it, that, like, Mitch Fatel meets this hot, you know, stripper, and she's bisexual, and then all of a sudden I'm on the road and she can date girls, and how do I deal with that on the road? And that was the whole idea. And when A&E came to us, we were like, aren't you the network that does Duck Dynasty? And they said, yeah, well, we want to get edgy. Mm-hmm. And whenever you hear that, I think you have to be a little scared, because when someone says they want to get edgy, that means that when it really sees what it is, they get scared. And the day before we shot the pilot, they said, and we want to take out the part where she's bisexual.
That's the whole point of it.
That's the whole thing. So then it was just me and her kissing each other a lot and eating cake. But it was really funny. It came out really funny, and we actually thought, oh, they're going to buy it. And then they said, and then we'll introduce it slowly. And then the way TV works these days now is you need like 12 people to say yes to something on a network. And they had basically like 11 wanted it, and one guy at the last minute said that it was going to be too risque for the network, because the whole thing had just gone down where the guy on Duck Dynasty, Robertson, had said that he hates gays or something.
Yes.
And they said that they thought it would be...
What better way to combat that than to put a bisexual broad on there,
but they didn't want
to
get their audience upset, because their audience is supportive of Phil Robertson.
Oh,
so they thought... So
a
we
bunch
thought,
of
well,
rednecks
we,
is what you're telling me.
Yeah.
Yeah, but even rednecks love bisexual chicks.
That's what I thought, right?
Right. Who doesn't like bisexual chicks?
Yeah.
Maybe the Bible thumpers don't like bisexual chicks.
But I think that's why they're Bible thumpers, because they like them too much, and they get upset at themselves for that, so they try to...
Now, what's A&E going to do? So who then goes and tries to sell this concept to someone else? Or A&E does?
No,
who owns it?
A&E owns it, but they have like six other networks under their whole, you know, A&E umbrella.
Yeah.
So they're going to try to sell it to one of their sister networks. And then if that doesn't work, then the production company gets to try to bring it out and sell it to other stations. So
I see.
Yeah, so cross your fingers. It's so annoying.
Did you ever put this pilot anywhere? Did it run anywhere?
No. It just came out. It was just
put this
done
online.
I can't do it.
Well, tell the production company to put it out.
Yeah, I'd love to.
I mean, why not?
It's really good.
You want people to see? Are you proud of this?
I think I was shocked how proud I was of it, because I didn't think it was going to be good once they took out the fact that Jess was bisexual. And but instead, they let us go the whole bestiality angle. So I thought that worked really well with the donkey. So
did you see there's some video going around on the internet of a guy doing a boa constrictor, and not just letting it wrap around, but I guess boa constrictors have like a vagina. I guess I don't know.
Well, there goes my second pilot idea. There you go.
This guy's like doing a boa constrictor. I mean, it's I don't know. Do you ever get time to watch all this stupid stuff on the internet or no?
Well, first of all, I gave up watching porno. I have, because I used to waste way too much time with that, so I actually gave it up.
You did?
Gave it up cold turkey three years ago. Have not watched porno since. Haven't masturbated in 3 years.
Oh, my God. Holy
yeah, so don't even rub up against me, because I'll explode.
And, why'd you do this? Because you got married and you want to save it all for her? Or what?
Yeah, because I could have sex with her whenever I want. I'm getting a little bit older. I decide.
You're not always with her. You're on the road sometimes.
Yeah, so when I come home, though,
you
know,
ready to
it's
go.
On.
Ready to go.
Yeah. It's on.
Yeah. Okay.
So I gave up all that stuff. So, and I also wanted to be more productive in my life. I guess as I got older, I started feeling I wanted to be more productive, and I wanted to write more, and I wanted to work more on my career, and that kind of stuff. You know, what about you?
It was interfering.
Yeah, the Facebook stuff and all those posts and stuff, and I just decided.
Oh, I can't do all that stuff. Yeah. There's too many when you're in the public. I think if you're a teacher or whatever, or a firefighter, you may be able to keep up with all the people who are contacting you on Facebook and stuff. But
yeah,
I mean, there are thousands of people that are contacting, and it's like a
and
constant barrage. Twitter
yeah.
and Facebook and
constant.
Instagram. And I do keep up with all the tweets that people send me. I see those. I don't follow anyone on Twitter.
What I'm amazed about is the people that get offended by the stuff that you write who've been following you, and I get tons of people telling me, like, you know, you're the worst person in the world, because I'll say something about something. Like, I made a Tony Stewart joke, Twitter thing. And
the guy
just,
who killed the driver who killed...
Yeah, I just wrote...
What'd you say?
I said something like, he's now going to be in Miss Doubtfire 2, because Robin Williams had gone or whatever, and I was like, but he's not going to be able to drive himself onto the lot, Tony Stewart. And thousands of people started writing me that I should die and that I was horrible. And I was like, I just thought it was a stupid joke. And I didn't even think of it. And I was like, and I started realizing, like, oh, that empowers so many people that would never have a voice to then all of a sudden, they write you. They're so proud they're going to unfollow you. I'm unfollowed. Consider yourself unfollowed. And then 10 months later, they unfollow something else that you said, and you realize that they never, you know.
Right. It's like the people who say they're going to stop listening to the show, and then they continue to text every single day.
Yeah.
So what did you think about the Robin Williams thing? I mean, this guy commits suicide. Do you make jokes about that? Do you wait a while before you make jokes? What do you do?
I think as a comedian, what you thought is like, well, what would Robin want? Robin would want people to make jokes. He wouldn't, you know, so I just thought, I didn't even really make a joke about him because I didn't think there was anything that funny about it. I just thought it was sad, but I thought it was funny that the Tony Stewart thing happened about at the same time. So I just said, well, and then I think I wrote something... I don't even remember, but I just thought to myself, comedians make jokes about every, if you do that as a comedian, you expect other comedians to be making jokes about you. It's kind of our job, don't you think, mm-hmm. to make jokes about everything. And if you suddenly start deciding what is going to offend every little person out there, then you wouldn't make jokes about anything. So
do you ever have a joke and you're going to tweet it and then you go, well, wait a second, why am I tweeting this out? I should save this for the people that are paying me to see my act.
Because the tweets are so different than the jokes, I think. My jokes can't be tweeted. So the tweets are just like little thoughts I come up with that I know are going to offend people. I mean, I think, don't you get that as a radio guy, that like the second you know something's going to offend somebody, you can't wait to say it almost?
Sure,
yeah,
of course.
So that's what I do. So if I can come up with something like Tony Stewart driving onto a lot that I know is going to upset people, I can't wait to type it. And then I just start getting like nervous as I'm typing it because I want to get out so fast.
Do you, have you ever put anything out there that you regret?
No.
Never. Not one thing.
I think that when I said I love being gay... Because I'm not. Mm-hmm. So I was scared about
that. Why do you regret that? Now everyone thinks you're gay.
No, it's a joke.
Okay, all right.
No, I don't think I ever regretted it.
First time I met you, I thought you were gay. I go, that guy's
gay. I think you did think that, yeah.
But I'm honest about that.
But it's also because we had sex. So you have to.
That doesn't make you gay just having sex once.
But I think that's where you kind of thought maybe because I offered. And I think offering and doing are two different things. I just, no, I. I think I did. One time I regretted something about race because I realized that's the one thing you can't do. Is I had tweeted a joke about the fact that I had I'd got my teeth whitened and they were hurting. And I tweeted something about the fact that next time I'm just going to get really tan instead of whitening my teeth. It was just a thought I had. Apparently it's a Mitch Hedberg joke, and I didn't know that. I just tweeted that, like I tweeted that line or something, and someone started being, oh, someone's stealing from Mitch Hedberg, and they started, and a lot of text started coming in saying that I was stealing, and I wrote, hey, listen, I would never steal a joke from somebody. Obviously, I just came up with a topic that, and that happens. Right. Comics come up with other topics. So then, as a joke, I said, so here's another tweet, and I tweeted out a Richard Pryor bit. Like, that was obvious about black people be doing this. Like, it was so obviously not saying. And then all of a sudden, a bunch of people started writing me saying, we didn't know you were racist because it was. And I started, and then I realized, okay, that I regret doing. So then I said, that's a Richard Pryor bit. And that was a joke because I had just done the Mitch Hedberg joke that I didn't even know. And I explained it. And then I realized I'm just going to stay away from race.
What do you think about this shooting that took? You follow the news at all? This guy that was shot and killed by police in Ferguson or Missouri. I mean, this is, look, when something like this happens, it's amazing to me. Every white dude that calls this show believes one thing, and every black dude that calls the show believes the exact opposite of that. I don't know what happened. I guess we'll have to wait and see. But
I think Tony Stewart killed him. That's what I think personally. I think
Tony Stewart ran him over and they just left him.
That's what I think.
Oh, that's great. Now, do you pay attention to the news? Or comedy's not really about the news.
No. I'm not one of those topical guys. I'm just more into the sex and the love and the drugs and that kind of stuff.
Yeah. Do you do drugs yourself?
I've been doing a little bit of the X.
You have?
Like the X.
Yeah. How often are you doing that?
As soon as I can get a glow stick, I'll do it. No, we had to stop. Me and Jess were doing the X for a while, and then we were doing it way too much, so we decided to slow down on that because we had no spinal fluid left.
Yeah, that's a
every now and then we'll
thing.
Do a little bit of the white. Uh-huh. You know,
what was that cocaine? The white?
No, white out. We'll actually sniff the white out.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, every now and then we'll try that stuff. But if it's at a party or something, and someone offers it to us and shoves it up our nose, we'll
then you'll do it.
But I don't. I like it too much. That's why I can't do it regularly.
I've never done it.
You've never done it?
No. How old are you?
I'm 47.
47. All right. I'm 38. I believe Nancy Reagan when she told me that was my brain on drugs. I go, oh, my God. Look what's going to happen to me. See, you're a little bit older than me. You already knew. You go, this is BS.
I didn't do X until I was 42 years old when I met Jess.
What?
We were at a Jess is a crazy nutty swinger, and she brought me to one of her parties, and they all do the stuff there. And she's like, don't worry, you'll like it, and you'll be cool like me. And I said, so, and it's wonderful. But it does. It ruins your body, and after you do it, you're depressed for 2 weeks after that because it takes all the serotonin out of your brain. It squeezes it like a sponge. I'm assuming Dieter's done X, right?
I haven't.
You haven't?
No.
Oh, you guys have to come over tonight.
So you're depressed for 2 weeks. You feel great for a day or two.
Great for 6 hours, mm-hmm. and you just can't stop having sex, and you just enjoy life, and then all of a sudden you just have this crash, and you're just very depressed.
I did ecstasy. I've done that a couple of times in my life.
Yeah.
I was dating a porn star. That was the first time that I did it.
That's my dream.
And she gave I'm like, and I'm such a pussy. I'm not really into drugs, but I'm dating.
If you're
in
the porn star life, you're gonna.
Right. I mean, look, what's gonna kill me? The drugs or the diseases she's gonna give me? She's like, oh, let's do it. I don't know, man. I take this, and I don't know if you, I mean, you don't know me well, but I'm not the most outgoing, friendly person. You know, I'm just, I take this ecstasy.
Is it immediate?
No, it wasn't immediate.
No, it takes about an hour.
Yeah,
an hour,
it kicked in a while.
But slowly starts to hit
you. Take this, and then we had a beer, whatever. We go to this club, and I'm just like, I'm talking to random people. I'm like, hey, how you doing? A guy got, I think I told the story before. I don't know if I've ever told it while you were here, but a guy at this club got hit over the head with a bottle, and he's in the bathroom. I'm in the bathroom taking a whiz, and this guy comes in, blood dripping all down his face. And normally I see that. I go, ooh, I'm getting out of here. I don't want anything to do with this. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You don't know what's happened. Who just attacked this guy? Does this guy have AIDS? I don't know what's going on. I'm out of here. But I'm on ecstasy. This is like 15 years ago. And I'm like, I'm like, are you okay? I'm like touching his shoulder. He'll be okay. I'll get you some help. I mean.
Yeah. Well, actually, that's funny because the first time I ever did was at a pool party and there was another dude in the pool and Jess and this girl were kissing. And instead of us watching them kiss, we started talking about our family life.
Oh, I thought you said tonguing. Yeah. I go,
they started to
I go,
kiss.
You started tonguing. I go, what? You and the guy start tonguing?
Yeah, no. The girls start kissing and me and the guy were talking about our lives. And he's like, yeah, my mom never like really loved me. And I was like, and then all of a sudden out of nowhere, he goes, dude, I just love you. And I was like, I love you too. Like we were just saving this. Yeah. And that's what ecstasy does. And then we're like, anything that takes you. And then all of a sudden we realize like, oh, we should probably watch the girls kissing, huh?
Right.
And we're like, we'll talk about this tomorrow. Like we're going to be best friends. And we never talked again.
Yeah, right. Yeah. You want nothing to do with the guy.
It was Tony Stewart, actually.
all right. Let me take a quick break. And then we'll bring Mitch's wife in here. I've never met her.
Jessica,
she brought her because you guys have all these wild swinger stories that you always tell me when you come in
here. Well, she had them. I was the one who could never do anything, so we'll leave that for the break if I've done anything. Because you would always ask me, would I let her be with a guy? Because she lets me be with other girls, and I let her be with other girls.
Yes.
And she'd always wanted to be with another guy, and I said I never would get there. And so anyway, I said, oh, I'm going on Rover. I love the show. And I was like, you got to come to Cleveland. My school's about to start for her next week. So I brought her here so she could meet you finally. And you could ask her all the questions you were asking me.
Perfect. All right. Comedian Mitch Fatel is in the studio with us. He will be at the Improv tonight, 7:30. Friday, 7:30 and 10:15.
Yes.
Same times on Saturday and Sunday. One show, 7 o'clock. For tickets, call 216-696-4677.
These shows will sell out, Rover.
They will sell
out.
Once
I do your show. Seriously, every time I do your show, I sell good tickets afterwards.
Good. Go see Mitch this weekend.
Yeah.
Maybe
Rover will stop by.
Well,
come by with a hot girl and bring me and Jessica to a strip club and we'll have a good time.
Well, there's a strip club right across
Christie's.
From there.
Yeah, so and Jessica loved
Last weekend I was down, I didn't go to the Improv, but the place right next to there, you can dock your boat. And I have a big boat. Took it over there last weekend, and we partied over there.
Let's do it.
Maybe we'll do that this weekend.
I'm in.
I think tomorrow I can't do that. It's my girlfriend's fake birthday tomorrow.
What's that?
Well, you know, we do Roverfest, our big festival every year, and that was on July 26th. Well, my girlfriend, who I've been dating for a year, her birthday was on July 22nd.
Yeah.
So I'm so busy with Roverfest, and you know, you can't like. Mm-hmm. Screw a girl over on her birthday.
No,
you know?
I almost did that once and got a lot of
So she kept saying, oh, I don't need it. I don't need it, blah, 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 blah. But I know that that's a bad move. So I made a deal with her. I go, look,
sweet.
Here's what we'll do. Once Roverfest is over, everything calms down, we'll do your birthday. It'll be a fake birthday. We'll celebrate. I'll get you a gift or whatever. We'll go out to dinner, all that kind of crap that you have to do. We'll do it 1 month after your real birthday. So her fake birthday is tomorrow. So I have to take her out and do whatever she wants to do and go to all that sushi restaurant crap stuff that chicks... Oh, I can't
sushi.
Say, oh.
I've done that with my wife with a fake orgasm because I've put hers off for a couple of years now and just worried about myself. So I'm like, we're going to take care of you and...
Yeah, you know, I felt bad, but I just got so busy. You know,
no,
you're working
sure
18 hours a day on that stuff.
But that's what
Rover
you get
Fest.
When you have a boyfriend who's, you know, successful and takes care of everything and has a boat.
That's right. What, you think that boat's paying for itself?
No,
sweetheart, that's right. Let me bring in your wife, Jessica.
Jessica,
is her name?
Jessica. Beautiful Jessica. Fatel.
All right, because you guys have had quite a few stories, some ridiculous stories. Hi, what's your step there? There is a step
Look
there.
Look hot, honey.
People,
she does, Mitch.
Yeah. Hi, well, she's got a nice ass, nice rack,
and nice vag.
Oh, good. I can't see
show,
that. Maybe
$20.
She'll,
I'll show.
She'll
it.
Show that to us later. Hi, how
Let
are you?
Let us on the boat.
How did you, let me see, what mic?
Blue mic.
I'm blue. Okay, there we go. All right. How did you guys meet, Jessica?
We met in Addison, Texas, and Mitch was performing there, and my best friend was a fan of his.
Yeah.
And my
Heather
husband.
Heather was hot.
My ex-husband had just left 5 days prior to that show. That first show was like a Thursday night.
Yeah.
And so she told me to get up, get shower, we're going out, and we're going
to
see.
You didn't want to go. You wanted to be miserable, right?
Yeah, not even miserable because I liked the guy. Just I felt like I was insulted. I was like, if anybody should have left, it would have been me.
Why'd your ex-husband leave you?
He left because he was not happy, and he needed someone who liked him for like all the stuff that he...
Another man.
Yeah.
No,
no, it wasn't. It was just. You know.
It just didn't work out. So 5 days later,
I went to go.
You go to see Mitch, his show of his.
Yeah, and my best friend's husband, they were swingers. He texted her during the show, and she showed me the text, and it said, "Why don't you guys take him back to Jessica's house and give him a threesome?" And I was like, "Yeah, I can do whatever I want." So. So that's exactly what we did, and that's how we met.
Her opening line was, "It's too bad you don't use condoms, because if you used one, me and my friend would give you a threesome." Because I used to have a bit in my act about how I don't use condoms.
Yeah.
And she said, "Too bad you won't." And I said, "Actually, that's just a joke.
That's a joke. It's comedy. It's all made up."
I'm the king of condoms.
I wear 3 condoms.
I'm wearing a condom right now.
Just in case.
Wow.
So that's really how
Were you doing that just because you wanted to get back at this ex-husband of yours?
I wasn't doing it to get back at him. I was just more so doing it because I was like, I had that like flash of realization. Like, I can do whatever I want. So, yeah. So
you thought I was cute, right? You thought I had the cute dimples, you said.
Yeah, you do. He has an ungodly amount of dimples. It's an uneven amount. There's 7.
Yeah.
It's just weird, but it's cute.
But every time I'm like, "You really were attracted to me, huh? You want to give me a threesome?" He's like, "No, it's less about you and just having fun and asserting my autonomy."
It wasn't you. Now I do because I love you.
Because you love me.
But I
don't know. I didn't know how to have like... You're probably better at this than me, but I don't know I didn't know back then how to have like porn sex. Like I used to just think you just have to look girls in the eyes and make believe you were in love with them.
Yeah.
Because I thought that's what you're supposed to do.
That's weird in a threesome.
And I was like looking at her really lovingly, and she's like, "You're creeping me out." And she said that. And she goes, "You're really creeping me out." She goes, "But you're so sweet and you're so cuddly. So why don't you hang out after this and we'll have sex all night. And then I'll make you breakfast in the morning."
Wow.
And we've been together for 5 years.
Ever since. How old were you at the time when you met him?
28.
28 years old.
So.
How long had you been married for?
Been married for a little over a year and a half.
2 years.
January will be 2 years.
No, not you. When you were your ex-husband.
7 years.
So you were, so you got married when you were young.
He's
you were
Tony 20, Stewart. 20, Tony Stewart.
I was 21 when I got married.
So you were 21 when you got married.
Yeah.
And were you a swinger during that period, during this marriage?
Yeah.
When did you become a swinger?
Well,
when you met that guy, was this a guy that opened your eyes up to the lifestyle, as they call it?
No, actually, I got him into it as well. So it's been my
dirty
thing.
Dirty slut.
So I was always like that, though. When I was 16, I tried to put together my first threesome and with my best friend and her boyfriend. It was his birthday. And I was like, "You know what we should do?"
Oh, my God.
And we got matching bra and panties and stuff. And I think he was 17. We were 16. So he was just nervous. He just went and literally like, played drums in the corner.
And he wouldn't do it.
Yeah. So I mean, I was always like that.
Played drums with his penis.
I was always like that.
I've heard of banging the skins. I mean, come on.
He did it the wrong way.
Yeah.
So I've always been like that. And then my boyfriend before I got married, the guy didn't end up marrying. He said he wanted to see me with another guy, and I'd never thought of that. Like just a guy watching. And I was like, really? Okay. So he kind of got me into that.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm always like, I don't know. Maybe I'm a hippie at heart. Like, you know.
When was your first? How old are you? The first threesome that you had?
The first successful one, I guess, was like 19 probably.
19. All right. Mm. And when this boyfriend that wanted to watch you bang out another guy.
Yeah.
How old are you at that point?
18.
18.
Yeah.
Wow.
So I had an early start.
Who was the guy?
Wild.
Obviously. Her, yeah. Who was the guy? His friend or something? Or who was it?
I picked. So I actually picked a guy that I knew from high school that was like, because I don't think I want a stranger for the first time for that. I want somebody that I know. And so.
So did you already had sex with that guy that you picked?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
It was Nate, right?
Yeah,
Nate.
How?
I've had sex with Nate.
So. Yeah, I bet.
Everybody's had sex with Nate. So.
Now. Okay, so this guy that you're dating, he goes, "I'd love to see you have sex with another guy."
Mm-hmm.
How old is he? Is he older than you? This sounds like a creepy 30-year-old is what it sounds like.
You were
18, roughly.
I was 18, he was 25.
Okay, all right.
So I'm a little older.
So you pick the guy, and how do you broach this subject to the guy? I mean, you must have to call him and say, "Hey, listen, I'm dating this guy, and he wants to have you come bang me while he watches.
That is pretty much verbatim, exactly.
Well, a normal guy is going to go, that sounds good. But I just want to make sure the guy's not going to mount me from behind while I'm doing this.
That's always the question that follows.
Right. Yeah. Okay, so he asked that question, this guy. Okay.
Yeah.
So you say, and what does he say? He goes, oh, yeah, I'll go ahead, I'll bang you?
Yeah, or? Well, this guy has, you know, a few morals anyway. So.
Okay, so he comes out, he bangs you out in front of this, in front of your mm-hmm. boyfriend. And that's sort of your first experience into, like, doing it in front of other people or whatever?
Yeah, I always liked girls. So the idea of me being with a girl and a guy was, that felt like normal because I like both. But the idea that a guy would want to see that, I was like, oh, okay, well, that's interesting. So,
Yeah.
You know, I'm not shy when it comes to that kind of stuff. And I feel like I would never... I'm always in control. Like, it's not like I don't have any kind of like rape fantasies, and I wouldn't want to and I was never that girl that just was like passed out of parties and all that kind of stuff. But I feel like it's good.
She just
for,
likes to run things. She's kind of like the ringmaster. Yeah.
I like to own my sexuality. I'm not afraid of it. So.
Now, Mitch is a small guy. I mean, it's height-wise. What about his penis size?
He can hang. Literally.
He has like an average size, you know.
Yeah, it's bigger than average.
It probably even looks huge on him because
he's
so small.
I'm only 5'5", so on me it looks humongous. It's almost like when you fake throw the ball at the dog, like, you know, like they just kind of have that look, like it looks like it should feel bigger than it is.
Yeah, So you guys... Wow. And you tell people this story, this is how I met my wife. I had a threesome with her the first night.
Well, the truth of the matter was, you know, it's, and I say it and it's kind of sweet, actually, because it's romantic to me that I thought I was getting my first threesome ever, but I actually met my wife. And it was like, so people always go, that's the best story, because I used to do a bit in my act about that I had never had a successful threesome. And it's true. I've had a couple. And as you probably know, and you guys are in show business, you know, the threesomes are never as successful as they look in porn movies. There's always one girl crying, one girl throwing up. There's always some girl confused who's, you know, wandering back and forth saying you should call an ambulance for her. Like, there's a lot going on in those things. So I had never had a successful threesome, and I always wanted that kind of porn threesome. And Jess's friend is just as hot as Jess, and they came over to me. And they were like, we want to give you our first. And so it wasn't for the first time me trying to set it up. It was like two girls that were like, we want to blow your mind.
Mm-hmm.
And they did. But then in the middle of that, that's when I actually, and it's kind of sweet. Like, I did like have this moment, and Jess says that I'm making this up. But while we were doing it, Jess smiled at me. I remember thinking to myself, I'm going to know that smile for the rest of my life. Like, I fell in love with her. And her best friend, who was having the threesome with us, said, I felt that there was a connection between you guys, and she left.
It's funny. Jess just happened to fart at that moment. She was smiling because she thought, you know.
You don't fart, do you?
No.
Yeah, of course.
Ladies don't.
And when she does, it smells.
You know what's funny is that the girl that, now that we've, during the commercial break, Mitch and I deciphered who the girl is that I brought to a show a couple of years ago. I had a threesome with her, actually.
Was it successful?
Oh, yeah.
It was a good one.
Of course. All my threesomes are successful.
Oh, so you have a lot of, we've had a lot of good ones together now, but I think you always have to have that. Like, Jess is so much fun to be with, so she makes them successful. But before her, they were all disasters for me.
Because you have to have a girl that's into it and knows what she's doing. It can't be like a guy that's like, you know what I want to do.
Right.
That doesn't typically work out
well. With me and two girls, I've probably only done that 3 or 4 times, I think.
Yeah. Well,
now, me and another guy of tag team chicks, probably another 3 or 4 times.
Oh, so you have no problem. See, that was my thing. You have no problem being naked in front of another man.
No, it doesn't bother me at all. It doesn't bother me at all.
You're my hero. Step up.
Yeah.
Guys are always like freaked out, like, dude, isn't that like gay? Or, I go, nah, as long as they,
as long as there's a girl in the middle.
Yeah, the guy's not touching me or anything.
I'm getting better at it because we've done that now, because we've been in. Because Jess will do anything because she had a bad childhood. So she'll do anything.
The root of the issue there.
Yeah, so I'm lucky to have that. I'm lucky to have that going for me. Yeah. And so when she started bringing me, because she knew when she met me, she's like, listen, your act is all about how you love girls, you love porn. Like, I'll show you fun stuff. And it was almost like calling me out. Like, we'd be in these scenarios and she'd be like, well, this is what porn is. Like, there'd be like hot girls just having sex with each other and the guys just kind of taking off their clothes. And I was always like, aren't we going to get to know each other first? Like, because I'm shy.
Mitch would really rather play like Scrabble first, just get it,
just get
a feel
to know
for everyone.
Right.
And then like, you know, pick your buddies and pair up.
Yeah.
But you're a seasoned swinger and you're not. You're just like, all right, we're here. We've had a drink. Now let's take off our clothes and go at it.
I actually usually take off my clothes before the drink.
You do? Really?
She loves being naked.
Now, how did you? Okay, so you have sex. A guy bangs you out in front of your boyfriend. And then how did you get into this full swinger lifestyle?
That actually came later after I was married the first time. And we had a group of friends that just kind of. Like a couple friends that started hanging out with a couple other friends that were swingers, and then they turned into swingers, and then we met like a whole bunch of these people, and after a while, it just became like, well, why aren't we doing that? And we actually were all friends first, so then it just was kind of like second nature, and it really isn't. Everybody thinks swinging is like that wild orgy situation, and there are those, and that's not really my style either. I mean, I will get butt naked and run around a room, but. I actually do like to have a group of friends that I already know.
Yeah, you don't go from partner to partner.
Yeah, I'm not like, it's not like I don't just jump in an orgy and just do anybody. It's like, it literally is people I'm friends with already. So that's kind of how that happened.
So explain this to me in a general sense. Now, every time is different or whatever. But when you became a swinger, you and your first husband, and there would be another couple, would you guys like swap couples, right? Would all four of you be in the same room and you'd be doing the other chick's husband husband would be doing her? That's how it would generally go down.
Yeah, usually I think that's like
that's
fair.
The PG version,
but
of
also
stuff she's done.
But, oh, yeah.
That's PG just doing
that's
that.
Not, no, that's not PG. That's you, like
you've done whole parties where. No,
I haven't done whole parties.
No, I mean not you personally, but you've been a party. There's been a couple of swappings.
Well,
going
yeah, but
on.
I'm saying, like just like as far as
the normal
of people,
the
I'm
normal
like,
you
protocol.
Like parties where I just like couples.
Yeah, but the parties usually work in the way though that like the girls usually start the stuff. There's always like most good swinger houses have a pool and
right.
like a party room, and all the girls
where
are getting.
Where do I find these good swinger
yeah,
houses?
Yeah, I could design one for you. All the girls are getting naked and dancing, and then the girls start to play around, and then like and sometimes nothing happens. But if something happens, typically it's like between like a pair, like it's like a you know. Two couples
see,
in this
I'm still
room,
learning too. This
and maybe
is,
like
yeah.
you know,
learning, yeah.
other couples will go off in okay. a different room. But like you know, there's not usually like a dog pile right. of 12 people
the,
all together.
The people that live in that used to live in my house. I bought a house. It was a couple years old when I bought it, and the people, at least a rumor. I don't know this for sure, but I had a lot of people tell me that the people that I bought the house from were swingers, and they I'd run into people. I live on a golf course and run into people on the golf course and they'd be like, oh, yeah, I've been in your basement. I go, all sorts of stuff was happening down there.
I really believe in it, though. I believe in it like as a lifestyle and like Jessica's like I think we're having such a successful marriage because of the fact that we never have to wonder if you're ever going to be able to touch another person ever again.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that that's what brings most marriages down. It's a jealousy kind of thing. And it's not necessarily that we do anything. It's that we always have the potential for things to happen. Mm-hmm. And that's what I think.
All right. Now, I've seen this or talked to people about stuff like this. And as long as both people are into it, it seems to work. I agree. I don't see anything wrong with swinging. But if one person is into it or more
it's
into it, then it's a disaster. Now, have you, Mitch, ever gotten any tinge of jealousy over the past five years?
Yeah, of course I have.
You have?
Yeah.
From what? Tell me.
Wondering if she would like another guy more. But we never full swung until just recently, and it was kind of forced on me. I was raped by a girl at a party.
Look too miserable.
I was raped. we went out with a couple, and the couple, and our rules are, because we had never done a full swap thing.
Okay.
And so our rules were soft swap, and you know what that is, I'm assuming, right? Soft swap?
Well, this is not actual intercourse. It's
just playing
like,
around.
Other stuff,
it's like being at
school. Oral
like,
and that
kind
of stuff.
It's like 7 minutes in heaven with the, you know, like that kind of thing.
Right.
Which I love, because I'm still stuck at 16 years old. I'm fine with girls' hands. So our rule was, that's what we do. So the girl, we were all undressed, me and the other couple and Jess. And then all of a sudden the girl, can I say penis?
You can say penis, sure.
I just want to say it has nothing to do with the story. The girl looked at my penis, yes. And she said, I like that, and I want to do something to it.
Oh wow.
And I looked at Jessica to save me. Jessica's like, well, I'm not gonna say no. And then she just raped me right there.
Yeah.
So once she did, then he had rights to my wife.
Yeah, right.
It's only fair.
That's the way that it is.
All of a sudden, I'm stuck there. He put, and I wondered, would I be jealous? Because I was not. I was like, and then there's Jess with the dude, and I was like, wow, it's kind of hot. I was really shocked at how hot it was. And that's when Jess is like, you've come to the dark side now. Like, you know, I'm definitely I'm a swinger now. And that was exciting for me.
So there's been no other times where you've been jealous. You thought maybe she likes some girl,
Jess is,
even a girl more than you.
We recently had a situation with that.
Well, there's a couple of girl situations. The first girl situation was we were going to, when we got married, Jess said, as one of my presents to you, I'm going to get you a Thai hooker in Thailand, because we got married in Thailand.
Yeah.
And we went, and the Thai hooker that we were picking up said that she wasn't interested in me, but she'd like to have sex with Jess. So I said, sure. So we came home, and she said to me, I don't want you to do anything. And I was like, that's fine. I just want you and Jessica to have a fun time. And they started going crazy. And I took a video of it. And on the video, you can see me every now and then, like my penis just come in a frame and then kind of get pushed away. And I realized, like, oh, she really doesn't want me. She just wants Jess. Mm-hmm. So Jess is louder than I've ever heard her before. And I'm sitting there going, like, oh, Jess feels bad that the girl doesn't want me.
Uh-huh.
So she's putting on this great show for me. So afterwards, I said, honey, I just want to say, like, thank you so much for putting on just such a good show. I know that you felt bad. And Jess is like, I didn't even know you were in the room. She's like, that's the best girl I've ever had in my life.
Wow.
And then I was like, not jealous, but I was like, what did she do that I, you know? And then you realize, like, oh, you'll never be able to do it.
And this was a Thai hooker?
Yeah. Yeah. She, I don't know how seasoned she was at it, because she said she didn't have any interest in being with any guys.
Right, yeah.
Are you sure this wasn't one of those lady boys that looks like a woman, but it actually is packing some heat down there?
Yeah, we took a shower together. No heat.
Okay, all right. Because I've heard about
this. That was a woman.
These.
And afterwards, we dissected her, and we found no male parts. Because she's dead now, of course.
Yeah, of course. It's all good. The Thai hookers are.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
These stories get worse every time we tell them. Anyway.
Wow.
Yeah. So that was and then... And then I learned a long time ago, because I do get that question a lot, are you jealous by what girls can do to her? And I said, well, but no matter what, once you give yourself over to understand that you'll never be as good as a girl, you'll just never know. And that if Jessica was going to be a lesbian or wanted to just be a lesbian, she would be a lesbian. But she wanted to marry me, and she's in love with me, and we have a great sex life. So I'm like, so Jess has taught me not to be jealous, because Jess gets upset if another girl's not tighter than her when we have sex with another girl.
Or at least as tight as.
She gets, oh, wow.
Yeah.
I mean, that's like spoiled goods if she's not.
Yeah. Like me and Jess, we picked up a really hot stripper once, and I had sex with the stripper, and Jessica's like, she's really tight, right? And I was like, no, not really. And she's like, oh, damn. Like, Jess really upset.
Yeah.
Jess is a giver.
Now, Jessica, how old are you guys now? You're 47. 47. How old are you?
33.
You're 33.
Mm-hmm.
That's a fairly big
show business
age difference. Right.
Yeah, my stepdad's 2 years older than him.
Oh, really?
I call him Pops.
Yeah.
Are you guys able to, do you allow her to have sex? She can have sex with other girls while you're away?
That's no problem.
That's not a problem.
It is for me. I've discovered that they're quite nuts. Well, how do you guys date?
I mean, unless they're me.
And then.
Yeah. The crazier they are, the better they are in bed, though.
Yeah. I don't know that that's true, because I recently found a really crazy one, and she's really hot.
Because
you know, you hear that, too. You can't get a really hot without being crazy. And so this was definitely true to form. But good in bed, no. Like, just like not willing to open up and have any fun herself.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. Just wants to please us.
It sounds good, but in reality, it's a very weird situation, because you know that other person's not actually just enjoying everything.
Yeah.
And I think that makes me feel
weird. She
wants
to put on a show for us all the time, and we're like, just relax and enjoy yourself. And she's like, no, I am. Like, I just want to make you guys
happy. How often are you guys doing having sex with other people involved?
Not that often.
It's really not that often. It sounds like
once a month, every other month, once a week.
Not even that. No, not even. Not even once every other month. It's just kind of like whenever
it happens.
It happens. We don't go pursue it. I'm still trying to get him to go to a swingers club with me, but he hasn't ever been.
You've never been to a swingers club?
I don't like being in public. I'm like,
and he doesn't like clubs.
I don't like clubs, and I don't like being in anything but on stage. And I don't like. And afterwards, I like to run back to the apartment and put on my pajamas. And then if there's a swinger situation, I like that. So she's more...
Open a swingers club then. How about that? Yeah, in your apartment?
But it's the kind where you just have pajamas and play Scrabble like and see what goes on after
But she's not allowed to have sex with other guys when you're not around.
No, and that's...
Nor would I want to. I honestly am not that much into doing stuff with other girls when he's not around either. Because I did have this... So I met a girl on Tinder, and that's the girl I'm talking about. It's crazy and hot. But I had her over a couple of times when he wasn't there, or like she'd come over the day before he got home, and she'd stay overnight, and then he'd be home the next day, and we'd all play around. But I didn't like being there with her alone. Like, I don't think I have a good dynamic with just girl on girl.
Yeah.
But I also, like, as far as guys go, like, I'm not doing it. There's different kinds of swinger couples, and some swinger couples like to date outside of their, you know, core relationship and stuff. I don't believe in that. I think it's something that's a sexual situation we can both find joy in and both think is hot and do together. But I'm really not interested in the separate
stuff.
Look
at this rock on her finger. You could tell Mitch really didn't want to let this one go. Look at
I scooped her up.
I mean, boy, this guy.
I scooped her up.
That was at least three shows at the, I mean, wow. No, that's a big ring. You didn't want to get rid of her, did you? Wow. This is fascinating to me. Do you can see this continuing forever, Mitch? Well, I mean, what are you going to be like 60 with your saggy balls still running around having
so young,
threesomes and stuff? Yeah, I'm just wondering. I mean, does this go forever?
Well, this is what I think we'll do. I mean, this is why I think that we're going to work doing this forever, because what she just said is like, we don't go out really look like there are other couples that just like people always tell me, oh, Mitch Fatel's in an open relationship. And I'm like, it's not an open relationship. Mm-hmm. It's just a relationship where we like to have fun with other people around, but we would never go out and dating. And so in our minds, as long as there are people, and you have no idea how many girls, I talk about her being bisexual on stage, how many girls come over to us right after the show and they're like, where's your wife? I want to hook up with her. When girls get a little alcohol in them, they just want to hook up with girls. Girls love girls. Yeah. And so I think that'll go on. And when it's done, because in my mind, all I really need is this. Jess used to be a stripper, and I used to fantasize about being with a porn star my whole life. That's why when you told me you dated a porn star, that's all I ever wanted.
Mm-hmm.
So she's the most conservative person I ever met, but when we have our fun nights, just us, she'll play the porn star for me, and she'll play those parts for me, and that just keeps me happy as anything anyway. So all the other stuff to me is just extracurricular, and if it happens, it's just as fun. But it's not as if without it, I miss it. Like, does that make sense? Like, I have so much fun with her.
It's an
anyway.
Added benefit.
When you came to the show with your porn star girl that I met last time, why was so
She wasn't actually a porn star.
But she looked she could be. She was dressed like one.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm sure we could have
Jess can
porn.
Dress like that too for me, and then I can live out that whole. And then I do the whole like, then I'm the strip club owner guy. Like that's my fam. Always like, come on, turn around, bitch, and you know. And then like, she'll let me. I'll be like, you're auditioning for me. You get on the floor and show me what you can do. And like, she'll be like, okay, I'll do whatever you want. And then like, so she'll do that
so
for me.
So untrue to reality.
And you have huge. I know it's radio. If you're not watching RMG TV, she has huge creams.
Massive.
And what do you think they are, Dieter?
It's double D.
Yeah.
Is that what they are? 36 double D?
34
double D.
Yeah.
Holy moly.
I never noticed.
100%, 100% natural, right? Of course.
Natural silicone,
of course. Yeah. So you were a stripper.
Yeah.
Were you a stripper when you met Mitch?
Kind of. I was actually working as an executive assistant at the time, but that company was like getting dissolved, and I was having to go and supplement my income.
Did you enjoy stripping? Some girls love it. Some girls hate it.
I did enjoy it for like the first 3 years. I enjoyed it. I mean, I grew up in a small town. My family didn't have a lot of money. I wanted to get out, and that was my ticket. And so I really did. I enjoyed the freedom. I enjoyed the money. I enjoyed being sexy. I mean, there's definitely a feeling when you walk out on stage and like that whole like all eyes on you thing. If you know, if you like that sort of thing, it's a rush.
Yeah.
It's a power trip. And that was fun. And then you kind of start to realize that every day is the same and it always feels kind of depressing. And I mean, just for me anyway. And the money gets to be something that's like kind of an addiction and you can't quit it and you wish you could. So then because you can't live in the real world and just, you know, you need your car fixed, it's going to cost $1,500. Like, that's a big problem for a lot of people. If you're a stripper, one night, done. And so and so you can't break out of that cycle very easily. So that's...
You have to meet a comedian. That's hard to find sometimes.
Yeah. Did you ever sleep with any of your customers?
No.
Never.
There were couples, because he always asked me, like, because sometimes couples would come into the strip club.
I think it would have been hot if she would.
And I really wanted to go home with them. I really, sometimes there's a hot couple, hot girl, hot guy. And I just like, I first of all like the girl in that situation, that she's cool like that. And it's like me. I guess I like me. And I did. There were times I really would have gone home with a couple, but I couldn't because I was.
Did anyone ever offer you money for sex?
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Did you ever do it?
No.
You never did it.
I got offered a lot of money.
Mitch would have. He'd think that's kind of hot too.
I have a question for you. Yeah. Did you ever touch a girl while you were stripping?
Yeah.
Go on.
Yeah.
Do I know this story?
I don't know. You know most of my stories.
Yeah,
I don't know.
I like all their stories.
Yeah, I always dance
how,
for girls.
Jess, how old were you the first time you had sex?
15.
15
and a half,
years.
But, 15. You know, when I was
How old was the guy? 15. Was he also that same age?
Yeah, same age.
So he was that same age. Wow, she's so sexually liberated. Yeah. What do you think
Mitch
it is?
Mitch is lucky. I don't know.
Is it true? Like Mitch says, he had a horrible home life. Is that accurate?
Well, that was definitely true. And I guess I saw my mom being a whore. So,
strippers don't usually
Wait, your
come.
Mom was a whore?
No, she wasn't a whore. My mom got married pretty young. And when my parents got divorced, I was 12. And my mom was kind of like, woohoo, I'm single again. And
I totally get that. A bunch of different dudes in and out, basically.
Yeah, but I get that. So it's like not like there's any animosity there. I mean, I have a great relationship with my mom. But I did see that
her mom's
kid,
had a threesome with us. So.
That's gross.
Well, honey, it was acceptable.
Have you ever met Jeffrey on our show, the really weird guy? That's his underwear hanging up there in the hallway.
I wish I lived here so I could hear your show.
The guy is, wow, he's the strangest dude you'll ever meet.
Ever.
I don't know. Is he? He's like half autistic, maybe. He's kind of like Rain Man, but I don't know what the guy's story is. The first time, was it the first time he had sex with his wife? I'm talking about the Niagara Falls trip. You know what I'm going to tell. This guy goes to Niagara Falls. It might have been their honeymoon. Was it his honeymoon?
It was their honeymoon.
With his wife, who also is a little out there, a lot out there. And they go with her mother, his mother-in-law. They're in the same hotel room. He has sex with his wife while... The mother is there in the room. They had like two beds, like two double beds.
That's
She's in the bed next. I go, what was she doing? He goes, watching TV. Jeffrey.
She didn't know what we were doing.
Oh, come on.
You know, we always make sure her mom is passed out before we
leave. Right? Which she does every night after a couple drinks.
Now, do you guys have any kids?
No, kids.
We won't have sex with kids. We're against it, and we think that it should only be adults we have
sex with. Do you want to have kids? Not sexually. I'm talking about squirt them out of that vagina.
Not exactly like that, but hopefully it's that easy. In a couple years, maybe one. Both of us didn't want to have kids, and we actually had an appointment to get him snipped.
Yeah.
And it was years ago now, and we just kept putting that appointment off, and neither of us are like that. We always do what we need to be doing.
Yeah.
And we kept putting it off, and so finally we said, why are we putting this off? Like, what's behind that? Because I'm going to school to be a therapist,
and
so I like
cried.
To analyze everything.
We cried one night because I was like, I don't want you to have my baby, and she's like, I don't want you to have yours, and then we cried, and then we watched Thelma and Louise.
So you're going to school to be a therapist?
Yeah, sex therapist.
A sex therapist? Yeah. Oh my God.
Yeah, I got to figure out what's wrong with him. Or myself, for that matter.
You know, some sex therapists actually have sex with their clients.
Not like those are surrogates.
You're not going to be a sex surrogate.
I'm not going to be a sex surrogate. No.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. No, I'm actually going to try to go a little deeper than that. Like why a sex surrogate would want to be a sex surrogate. Figure them out.
What about your father? Your parents got divorced. Did you maintain a relationship with him at all?
I have a little bit of one with them. My dad struggled with addiction and stuff his whole life. My little brother does too. So it's like I had a...
What were they addicted to? Where are you from, Texas?
From Oklahoma.
Oklahoma. Yeah. What were they addicted to? What's a big drug down in Oklahoma?
Honestly, my brother. But my dad actually was really just alcohol. I mean, he was just an alcoholic. And then My brother is like has a whole set of dentures, and he's 30.
Yeah, oh my full god! Dentures. You're kidding me?
Yeah. I'm not kidding. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, it's really yeah. So that side of like,
meth is. I mean, yeah, it's her father. It's meth didn't become big up until maybe what 10, 15 years ago.
He's the one that stole the ring for me to give her to get her meth. So that's how it worked out.
Wow. I mean, that must be very sad then for you too.
It is. Yeah. I remain distant from it. I didn't stay home around my family.
He's such a sweet guy too. He's such a sweet guy. He's such a sweet guy, and he
does
wants
he have Gary
to...
Busey teeth now? Like when you see him in these dentures, are you like, whoa, no, dude, look at these teeth?
They're your mom little... paid for him to have good, nice teeth.
Yeah,
right?
But they do look a little like weird, especially after I saw him with rotten teeth for years, and then now he's just got like, you know, I mean, I know they're fake, so I think then mentally I'm like, those are so fake.
Right.
But he's a sweet kid, and my dad is too. He's, you know, they both have a heart just like so big, they'd give you the shirt off their back if it was the last thing they had, but they just kind of battle with a lot of demons, you know, personally. And so, so I have a strained relationship with like everyone except my mom, actually.
Yeah, you and your mom.
I have a little sister too,
lately.
Who's a stripper now. So it's like, I didn't want her to go down that path. And you know, so I just,
but
stay
I got
away
her into
home.
It and she's making us good money. So
and you have a threesome with her scheduled for next week, right?
Well, we wouldn't want to have a schedule
no,
with her sister.
My sister.
She's wacko.
Like not in a good way. Like not in like a hot wacko way.
Yeah. She's like,
she good looking though.
Yeah, she's hot, but she's, yeah, she's just,
she would she never. She's a lot prettier.
You wouldn't have you wouldn't have a threesome with Jess and her sister.
No. I would be honest. I tell Jess everything. That's something I would stay far away from.
Jess
so
and her mom.
Would
you do Jess and her mom?
Jess's mom is really hot.
She is hot.
And Jess told me she
late.
Loves me lately, so we're working on that. But your mom has told me she loves me, and she looks
know,
at me kind of sexy. But
sweet, and you're turning into some gross.
Her mom is. That's like one of the reasons I know that when you said that question, are you guys going to be together for keep doing this for a long time?
Yeah.
Her mom's in her 60s,
50s. No, she's 58.
And she's a hot-looking woman. I mean, if I showed you a picture, you so I know that Jess
your
is
your mom
genetics,
a swinger, too, Jess?
Good.
Is she into
we
that?
No,
thoughts.
But because she and her husband are way too jealous of each other now. Like, yeah. They don't have a relationship where they could do that. But she said something one day. I was in the kitchen cooking with my mom. Not just my mom. And she said something about this house we used to go to, which I remember. Mom's always been in bands and stuff, like cover bands, since I was a baby.
She's a rock star.
And she said something about this house we used to go to that when we were there, she said, most of the adults would go upstairs and, you know, mess around, but I never did that. And my mom has said everything of this, like, I tried pot, but it wasn't for me. And I tried meth, but it wasn't for me. And I kissed a girl once, but it wasn't for me. So when she says, like, they would go upstairs and do, but I didn't do that.
I didn't inhale. It was the I didn't inhale.
Yeah, right. I'm like, whatever. I don't know what my mom was doing, but I'm pretty sure she was doing some freaky shit.
I have a question for you. I want to bring something back. You asked me if I'd be jealous. Do you think you'd be jealous if I was having sex with your girlfriend and you were having sex with Jess?
No. I wouldn't. No. I don't think my girlfriend would be into that.
It's the weekend.
But
that's
I keep asking. Believe me.
Give her some tequila. Just
you know,
mix it with ecstasy and Xanax.
But
she'll be into
it. But see, I'm the kind of guy. I've seen guys that really try to force their girlfriends or whatever to get into that kind of stuff.
Doesn't
I don't want to be like that.
No, and it's not pretty. Don't. Yeah. And as a girl who likes girls, I won't do that situation.
Right.
If I feel a girl is not into it for herself, I always run from that.
Or not only that. What I've noticed is, and I've really, it's been a learning experience since I met Rover. I've been in situations where I'll say to Jess, "Look at that girl over there," and Jess will be like, "Are you just trying to get laid? Because I'm not interested in doing that." And I realized, like, if I stay back, so we were at her mom's high school reunion recently in Wyoming,
like 2 weeks ago,
and out of nowhere, Jess just walks back, see the bartender. Like this cute little bartender.
Yeah.
She's going to probably be ours later.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
And that, like, just like at your mind. So if I stay back and, like, then I know that, like, and that's when I've learned that the guy can't make anything happen. If I push anything, I've come to her with girls have written me on Facebook, like, you know, I'd hook up with you and your wife, and I'll come and show it to Jess, and Jess will be like, why are you showing this to me? Like, Jess has no interest if it seems like I'm trying to.
Well, it was actually at first in our relationship, girls would write and they'd say because they'd flirt with Mitch, and then Mitch would go, well, I'm in a relationship now. But if you want to be with a girl too, then we can do this. I'm like, well, that's not really us hooking up with a girl, honey. That's
upset by that.
That's a fan. And I'm okay with fans. I actually stalk them in the back of the room. I stand at the back of the room in shows and look for hot girls in the audience. So I'm okay with fans.
She really likes girls.
But it has to be like a dual situation where we're both into that.
Yeah, she really likes girls. Like, she'll look for girls for her. And then I share. And then I just come in and jump on them like a koala bear and rub up and down and run away.
She really has a life. I mean, think
She's
about this.
She's an amazing human being.
Mitch, you think about this. You're the breadwinner. You're the one pulling in the dough. She gets to have sex with whatever girl she wants. You're footing the bill. I mean, You're putting her through school too, I'm guessing, right, Mitch?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. But I mean, but
mom's helping too.
Yeah, mom is helping. Mom's actually, you're right. Too. Yeah, yeah.
She never did anything for me.
This is, well, I guess it's give and take because she certainly seems to be given to you. So I guess it all works out, right?
And someday I'm going to be a hot doctor and I'll be making money and he'll be old and decrepit. I'll be changing his diapers. I want to say that
she wouldn't let me do any of this. First of all, she fought me on it for a long time. She's like, I know how to make my own living. I can take care of myself. I'll put myself through school. I don't want you to pay for. She's not into being. That's why she never slept with any of her customers. She doesn't care about being taken care of. She's very independent.
Yep.
And I had to say to her, no, I'm paying for this stuff because we're a couple now, and I'm seriously going to be taking advantage of this 10 years from now when I want to give up comedy and relax, and she's a doctor, and we're going to probably, like, you know, do some sort of TV show, whatever, with the comedian and the sex
and
therapist.
Writing and stuff like that. So.
Let me ask you a totally off-the-wall question that has nothing to do with you guys.
Love
but and the only reason I bring this up is
7 inches.
I just... so your foot size. I gotcha. Andrew Dice Clay.
Yes.
The only reason I'm bringing this up is because I never have watched stand-up from Andrew Dice Clay ever in my entire life. And last night, for whatever reason, you're on the internet, one thing leads to another, you're clicking, and this special from 1989, Andrew Dice Clay, is on YouTube. Like, the whole thing is an hour-long HBO special. I go, let me watch this. So I had it in the background while I was working.
Yeah.
How do comedians look at Andrew Dice Clay? I mean, in the history of comedy, I mean, I'm just wondering what you guys think of him. I'll give you my opinion in a moment, but
yeah,
what do you think about this guy?
Andrew Dice Clay bothers me a lot less than a lot of the newer comedians that aren't funny who sell out shows because they have TV shows.
Mm-hmm.
Getting that out of the way, I think.
Like who? let's throw some names.
You really want to go there?
Jess knows who you hate.
Certain people have TV shows that we know of.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Those shows are watched by people.
Uh-huh.
I don't necessarily think their stand-up is that great.
Okay.
God, I don't like Miss Piggy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So
Miss Piggy. Who's Miss Piggy?
Yeah, she's not my
well, yeah.
What?
Nothing.
Doesn't one of the girls look like Miss Piggy?
I don't know.
Amy Schumer.
I don't know.
I never heard of her. What's Amy Schumer? What?
Yeah, that's...
Never heard of her. Anyway, so Andrew Dice Clay, what I believe is this. I think he started out with something that was really cool. He had something that had never been done before, and he brought it to an extreme. And I always like comedians that do something original at first. I think Sam Kinison had something really original at first, and then it just became kind of the same thing over and over and over again. That's what I think happened with Dice Clay. I think when he hit, he was wonderful, but then I don't think he had enough real natural talent to sustain it after that, and then it just became annoying to me.
I'm telling you, I watched this thing. It was an hour-long special. I watched the whole thing. I go, this guy had actually no jokes.
It was
just shtick. Yeah. That was it. There was like
the nursery rhyme.
There was no there. It was, I couldn't believe it. I'd never, am I the only guy that never watched Andrew Dice Clay
stand up?
Did he sell
at the Garden?
Yes, he did sell at the Garden.
Yeah, give him credit for
that. It said, I looked on his Wikipedia page, first comedian to sell out Madison Square Garden 2 nights in a row, whatever.
That, man.
He did
an 89. You know, selling out a show like that doesn't make you a good comedian. It makes you famous. It's like, in my mind, there's comedians who have done that, and I'm like, that's not comedy. My best shows are the shows where there's 30 people, because that's what comedy's meant for. It's more of an intimate form. You know, once a comedian starts doing that to just show that he can sell tickets, I don't think it's about the art of comedy.
But Mitch really wants more than 30 people.
No, actually, I don't.
I'll
turn
tonight.
You away if there's more than 30 people.
Well, the guy from the improv wants more than 30 people at the improv.
I was actually going, like, when are there 30 people? But
North Carolina, I did 30 people.
Well, that was a brand, yeah, okay.
Just so like, you're lucky if you get 30 people.
It happens occasionally, but I was like, that's
no, I mean, sometimes, but I'm saying that those are some of my best shows where I can just be intimate with an audience, and I think that's real comedy. And I think that once you become the comedian that just wants to show how many tickets you can sell, you don't really care about comedy anymore.
Why do you hate Amy Schumer?
I don't hate
Amy Schumer. I just don't think she's funny. That's all. I mean, I just don't think she's funny. That's every comic thinks other things about other people, right? I mean, I don't think she's funny, and I've seen her act, and it seems like it's the same thing over and over and over again, and it doesn't seem to me to have any kind of uniqueness to it. But I'm sure she hates me, too.
Who do you think is fantastic?
Louis C.K. is brilliant. Brian Regan is brilliant. Dave Attell is brilliant. Mitch Hedberg was brilliant. Was not a Robin Williams fan, believe it or not. Didn't think he... I thought his comedy was annoying, quite honestly.
Yeah, me too.
I liked him as an actor better than a...
Great actor.
I mean,
horrible comedian.
Think,
yeah, there's a new comedian named Dieter, who I like a lot.
He's silent most of the time, but
it's his timing. He comes out, and it's the way he breathes.
And I actually like George Carlin, but we disagree on that. I really liked George Carlin, but we...
See, Jeffrey, you guys really have to meet Jeffrey sometime, because he is an aficionado of comedy, but comedy from the 1980s. Like, this guy, for whatever reason, he's 43, I think. He is stuck in 1986.
Gilbert Gottfried, that kind of stuff.
He will bring up, what's the black
Thea
chick?
Thea Vidal.
Thea Vidal. Have you ever even heard of this chick?
Worked with her once.
He's like... Thea Vidal's my favorite comedian. I go, I've never heard of this person. What?
She's good. No Amy Schumer, but she's good.
Or who else does he like?
George Carlin.
Yeah, he does. Yeah.
Eddie Murphy.
But any random people?
John
like
Panette.
John Panette. He,
Margaret Cho. The guy that did Bebe's Kids. Whatever that is.
The guy that did what?
The movie Bebe's Kids.
Bebe's Kids. What is that? I don't
it's
even
a movie
know.
Movie he quotes constantly. It's this cartoon from the mid-90s.
I don't even know
from
who that is.
African American comedian. He loves it.
I don't know who that is, but
Remember the guy. I just remember babies.
Listen,
you remember that?
If you guys have a threesome with Jeffrey, I will start a Kickstarter fund. We'll get you $100,000 to do this. I'm telling you. Would you guys do that for $100,000?
I don't whore myself out for money.
Listen, it would be put you through school. You'd be a therapist before you know it.
That's all right.
That's
just
all right.
Your offers.
You know what? You can do it, and you can pick a girl to do it with. You have fun.
By the way, I want to do say something about that, because we have a lot of dudes now writing us. Oh, if you want your threesome, we can. And I'm like, no, we do everything together. Like, we would never have. Like, this guy, Jeffrey, would have to have a hot girl with him, because I'm not interested in just watching Jess and another dude.
For $100,000, you're not interested?
And I'm not interested in doing it in front of his mom or her mom.
She'd be watching
TV,
honey.
That is.
You could put this on the internet. We could live stream this. I'd charge people $5. You'd make millions.
It sounds like a great business opportunity for someone.
Well, he is crazy.
You want to see what he looks like? I sent to Anthony.
Oh, wait a second. The monitor here on RMGTV times out at after 4 hours. So if I don't click it, we don't get to see what is happening on RMGTV. Let me see here. What is the? Hang on, it's warming up. There's Jeffrey. There it is.
That's what he looks like.
He's obviously hot.
Right.
That's a great picture of him. That's at one of our golf outings after.
That actually looks to me like Dieter if he let himself go.
Do you think maybe like in the 80s, maybe he did like too much acid or something, that's what this is a product of?
He doesn't do drugs.
No, he doesn't do drugs. He doesn't even drink. Like, that's a day after we forced him to chug like 5 beers. That's what he looks like.
I think he needs to do drugs.
He's just an odd guy. Let me go to Kevin, and then we'll let Mitch and Jess go. Let me go to Kevin. 1-866
Yo-Rover.
Of course, yes. Well, it's going
to
be a huge orgy. In fact, maybe I will take the boat down there, and we'll just have it'll be an orgy boat.
Yes,
man.
I've
never had you on a boat yet.
Yes. Kevin, you're on Rover's Morning Glory. Good morning, Kevin.
Yo, Rover.
Yo, what's happening?
Hey, real quick. Robin or Robert Harris was on Bebe. He did the Bebe kid voice.
Oh, all right.
Oh, the dad from House Party.
Okay.
And I just wanted to say, man, I was a swinger. I was a swinger for a couple years, me and my wife. And I brought back, I had a couple STDs, man.
Well, thanks for telling us that.
So you had STDs, yes. Okay, now, well, that's a good question. I've had some people send me instant messages about this, and how have you guys had any STDs? People have been wondering through text messages.
I can't get them a second time. That's how I look at it. So
is that? I don't think that's scientific.
I think it's immunity, honey.
I don't think there's scientific.
We practice safe sex.
Once you have the HIV, always have the HIV, right? Who cares? Yes.
Well, we practice safe sex. As a matter of fact, we've had other couples who have been like, you know, we're cool if you guys don't want to use condoms, and we're like, no, we totally have to, because we want to have babies and we're healthy and happy and we're in good shape and we work out and we don't.
Yeah.
It's never that. Sex to me is more. You know, sex to me is never really what it feels like. as much as it's psychological. Like, when a girl's giving you oral sex, to me, I'm like, when girls think we love that, I'm like, it feels good, but to me, it's just more the idea that they're doing it. It's just so dirty that I think is more a turn
on. That's what turns you on.
So to me, like, using a condom is kind of even dirtier. Like me and Jess had sex with a stripper, and she's like, I want to do it to him. And Jess is like, do you have a condom? And we went, and it was just, me and Jess always said the dirtiness of it was the fact that, like, oh, we're just kind of using her, like, just using a condom, and just, like, there's no interest in having a baby with her and that kind of stuff. And, you know, so we practice the safe sex. So,
all right. Listen, this is
safe sex.
This is fascinating stuff.
It can go on for hours, can it?
Wow, it really could. I don't know why in the world. I'll make a reality show of this. Let's do this. I mean, come on.
A&E missed the boat. No, we made
A&E's, it's not. No. You need a different network. A&E is not the right network.
We need RMG.
Yeah, you need some. I mean, you need. I don't know what network it could be, but
Spike TV or something. Yeah,
right, we're thinking Spike. We're thinking maybe Playboy. Cinemax.
Yeah,
we met with Cinemax, didn't we, honey?
We met with Showtime, not Cinemax.
So Showtime, yeah.
So.
Well, it's tough to get a show picked up. There's too many. There's a lot of cooks in the kitchen. They all have to agree on
and
it.
And even if you get it, like what happened with A&E, even if they shoot a pilot, you're not even guaranteed at all. It's like one out of every 100 pilots probably.
This is why you need to sleep with all the executives, Jess.
Is that what it is?
See, I've been doing it, and that's what's been messing it up.
You've been weirding them out.
Yeah, that's why you're never picked up.
You're never picked up.
You know, there was a girl on the Thursday hookup, which we do, which is a dating
thing. Yeah, we were listening on the radio.
Yeah. Did you hear the advice that I gave to her?
Was she hot? Just said she sounded hot.
She was
a decent
cute
looking
glasses,
girl. Cute girl.
Big boobs.
Yeah. But every time that she, you know, do you do this? Oh, no.
No, never.
Backdoor action. Oh, God, no, never. Threesome. Oh, no way.
Yeah.
Oh. And she asked earlier in the day, but right before we even started, you know, when she first sat down, she goes, she was telling us about her last boyfriend cheated on her. And she's like, that seems to be a trend. I don't know why these guys all cheat on me. 10 minutes into it, I go, honey, this is why these guys cheat on you.
I did hear that.
Everything you said is, ew, no. Well, she's the opposite. Jess is like, okay, sure. Yeah,
well, you have to be able
to.
Not with the back door, she's not.
I think you have to be able to, listen to what your partner wants and be able to at least like go there with them. Because if you don't have the comfort level with your partner to say, look, this is the freaky stuff I like, and them at least like try to entertain the idea, then they don't feel listened to.
Yeah, it's
not
true.
Not that life all boils down to sex, but that's a pretty intimate, big part of a relationship.
Yeah.
So you got to be willing to like try each other's freaky stuff.
And it is true, and that keeps a happy marriage, because a lot of the fantasies that I tell her I have, a lot of them are that I'm in the strip club guy, and she's always like, I want you to know, like, this is not interesting to me in the least, and I would never do this. But if it turns you on, and she'll play the part so well for me, that everything in my mind is like, okay, good, I'm satisfied. Like, I've lived out every fantasy I've ever won. I think as a man, once you live out the fantasies, then you realize they're not really as big a deal as you always thought they were.
Yeah.
And then you can kind of have a happy life. And so I think that's my advice to women out there is do for your man what you want. And guys have to do what the girls want as well.
Well, life advice there from Mitch Fatel, the swinger and comedian. The swinger comedian. He'll be at the Improv tonight at 7:30, Friday 7:30 and 10:15, and Saturday 7:30 and 10:15, and then one show Sunday at 7 p.m. They're really working this guy hard over there at the Improv. For tickets, call this number, 216-696-4677. That's 216-696-4677. And his website is mitchfatel.com, F-A-T-E-L. And I'm sure he has Twitter and all that.
It's
kind
at
of crap.
Mitch Fatel. And if there's any hot girls that want to come and go to Christie's with us afterwards, we'll stop by and get some strippers.
You guys going to Christie's every single night this, this
maybe.
Week?
Yeah, maybe.
If you can get us in.
Depends on how much we like it the first night.
You probably have some good connections.
No. I'm not a big strip club guy. I'm just, you know, it's you guys are taking the strippers home. It's a little bit different than when I go. I just pay them and they go, right.
They pretend to like you.
Yeah, right.
I'm fine with that, too.
All right, go see Mitch at the Improv this weekend.
All new
Mitch
material,
and Jess.
By the way. 45 minutes new material.
45 minutes of new material. There you go. Jess, it's a pleasure meeting you.
Nice to meet you, too.
Have fun while you are here. I have to take a break. We'll come back. We'll wrap everything up and we'll do all of our plugs.
Thanks,
right after this on Rover's Morning Glory. Hang on.
Love you guys. Rover's Morning Glory.